everyone, it's Marisa from bumblebeeapothecary.com. Today I'm back with another requested video talking about fibrous versus non-fibrous vegetables on intro. The GAPS introduction diet can be a little bit confusing when you're first trying to figure out which vegetables are allowed in those very first stages, so I'm going to talk all about that. So when we are following the GAPS introduction diet, it removes all of the most fibrous foods to give the digestive system a chance to rest and to make sure that we're not feeding the pathogenic flora, and just gives it a really easy time of very easy to digest foods as well as very nourishing nutrients. So that means there are some vegetables that are allowed in the beginning and some you add as you go through the stages. So there are a couple of places where you can find really good lists for which vegetables are allowed in GAPS intro stage 1, for example, and then when it's okay to add those next ones. Dr. Natasha has a more of a basic list in her books, and then Dr. Becky Plotner in her book has a much more detailed list as she takes you through each of the stages for what vegetables are allowed. But the main rule is pretty basic. You just want to avoid the most fibrous things. So, for example, in GAPS intro stage 1, we don't have celery. You can make meat stock with celery in there for flavor and then strain it out and don't eat it on stage 1. That's fine because it does add a very nice flavor to especially like chicken meat stock. But later on, all the way to stage 5 is when we get to add cooked celery. It's because it's one of the very most fibrous ones even when it's cooked, and so that's why you wait that long before you add it. But you can add it just for flavor and strain it out. That's fine. And then in stage 5 you get to actually eat it. And then there are lots of other vegetables. Like I said, they're all listed out in Dr. Becky's book, and I highly recommend getting this. It answers so many questions about what to add when and what's allowed and what's not allowed and just so many more questions. Fantastic book. Great companion to either one of these GAPS books. But there are other things to know about some of the other vegetables that are allowed from the start in stage 1. Number 1 is that you want them to be cooked very well so that they're very, very soft. And then number 2 is that when there are more fibrous parts to them, you want to make sure that you remove those. So for example, if you're doing cauliflower or broccoli, you want to make sure that you use just the top portions of those and not use the more fibrous stalks. Same things for summer squashes and things like that. You want to make sure that you peel those, remove all the seeds, and just use the soft flesh part. Anything else that you decide to do from stage 1, like artichoke or asparagus, same kind of thing. Only use the very softest parts and avoid the fibrous parts until much later. Stage 4 or 5 is probably okay to start adding those as long as they're cooked well. So there are a lot of vegetables allowed starting from stage 1. There are a few key ones. I'll go through and mention the ones that you don't add in stage 1 so that you can kind of have a heads up about that. In stage 2, you get to add green beans, celery root, and ginger root in cooked in dishes. Those are a little bit more fibrous, so that's why those wait until stage 2. In stage 3, you continue on with those same vegetables. Same thing with stage 4. There aren't really any changes as far as which vegetables are allowed. And then in stage 5, like I was kind of mentioning before, that's when you get to add cooked celery and cooked cabbage. So those you would not want to add any earlier than that just because they can be so fibrous. And then as far as raw vegetables, you're able to start adding raw vegetables in stage 5, but not raw celery just because that's even more fibrous yet. And then once you're in stage 6, you can add raw celery as well as raw cabbage. And then the last one worth mentioning is the sweet winter squash. So pumpkin is not included in this because it's not so sweet. Pumpkin you can have starting from stage 1, but the other winter squashes, sweeter, starchier winter squashes like spaghetti squash, acorn squash, butternut squash, any of those are going to be on full GAPS. And Dr. Natasha did have to change this partway through time as she was seeing how people were doing. It turned out that the starchier, sweeter winter squashes were too much for people on intro, but once you're on full GAPS, then those are okay. okay. So just to clear that up, because that was something that I know back before I did more training and reading and everything, I didn't realize that either, because in her original material, she does say to use winter squash right away, but she did change that. So winter squashes go on full. Pumpkin, you can have from intro stage one. I have this put together aloud and avoid food lists that I created from research from a combination of books and my GAPS coach training. And it is included if you decide to work with me inside my program, Follow GAPS Academy. I'll have a link down below where I have a free class on starting the GAPS diet where I talk more about how my program works if you're interested in that. So check out that description box below for information about that, as well as my 30-day meal plan that I have for GAPS intro. And I'll also have links down there to where you can grab Dr. Becky's book and then Dr. Natasha's books as well. I also wanted to just mention really quickly for those of you who stick with me and watch a lot of my videos and are kind of following my pregnancy and everything, is that this is the last video that I'll be putting out before the baby comes. I did work ahead with my filming so that there should be videos still coming out every 2 weeks while I take a break. So I'll be taking a little break from filming, but like I said, since I worked ahead and made extra videos, those will keep coming out for you guys. So the next time that I'm making videos, baby will be here. I'll do a little update so you can catch up with how we're doing and everything. But I just wanted to mention that so that it kind of makes sense. You'll still see videos coming out with me being pregnant even after baby is here. And if you want to check up on when baby actually comes and how we're doing and more, you know, current events, be sure to follow me on Instagram. I'm Bumblebee Apothecary on Instagram. There's a link down in the description box as well. So head on over there and make sure that you're following me, and then you'll know when baby comes, even if my videos are not matching exactly with that timeline. So I hope that you found that helpful. Hopefully that answered some questions, because I know those can be kind of confusing things in the beginning when you're trying to figure out what's allowed. And it's so nice to know, I think, that there is such a big variety, even from stage one. I mean, this stage one section is, it takes up this whole length of the page. So it's really nice to know that, and then to know those specific ones that you have to wait on. So hopefully you found that helpful. If you did like this video, give it a thumbs up, share it with anybody else who you think would find it helpful. And if you're new to my channel, please hit that subscribe button. I get out 2 new videos every week on nourishing recipes and natural living. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time. Bye.